Hello, this is a podcast of dialogic pedagogy. Dialogic pedagogy is a lesser known approach to education, which is very important in our view. We prepared these podcasts on topics that could be of great interest. At the beginning, we created about five topics for five podcasts that we will discuss. Our format will be about 20 minutes of discussion, and we would love to hear your opinions on Facebook, your questions, your commentaries, and your suggestions for other topics that we could discuss. So we are Dr. Eugene Mantusov.
Mm-hmm. Let me add something more to that. Mm-hmm. We plan to create diverse questions of your interest and discuss them. We want to invite maybe different people whom we might want to interview. But we want to make it more interactive in a sense, not only of your comments, but also we think about maybe you suggest new topics, or maybe you suggest staying on the topic. Within each topic, we prepared five questions. But we might not stay on these five questions. And in future, we will put a new topic and with the five questions. And maybe you also can contribute to the questions and the topics. We plan to do that, every week we try to do one podcast. And on that note,
I want to just present who we are. This is Dr. Eugene Mantusov, who works at the University of Delaware, a professor of education, and developed one of the main developers of dialogic pedagogy in the world, I would say, known in many different countries and for many of his books and articles.
And this is Anna Marianovich Shein, who is also contributed to the development of dialogic pedagogy. And she's very much interested in the difference between dialogic pedagogy and drama education and many, many, many other issues. And hopefully she will be here on our podcast and we can interview her about interesting, diverse topics.
Okay, with that, let's start with our first topic. So, what is dialogic pedagogy in the first place? We think that that's an introductory topic about which we have several questions. So what is dialogic pedagogy, please, Eugene, say in general and specifically for you?
Well, in general, I think that dialogic pedagogy involves any educator or educationalist who thinks that a dialogue is important for education in any way. So in this case, I would say dialogic pedagogy is, first of all, self-proclaimed field. So whoever thinks that dialogue in any way of understanding is important for education, again, defined the way how they want to define that. In my view, those people, it's our family of both scholars and practitioners who are interested in dialogic pedagogy. And in the history, probably the most known dialogic educator was Socrates. Again, not because he was the first one, but the first one that we know, and who through Plato articulated some of the ideas of dialogic pedagogy. So in this case, from that point of view, there are a big family of diverse approaches, rich diverse approaches in dialogic pedagogy. As in terms of me in particular, I think that for me, dialogic pedagogy involved, first of all, such name as Russian philosopher of dialogism, Mikhail Bakhtin. And it's based, I would call this approach ontological and critical dialogic pedagogy, and maybe many other qualifiers as well, and my views are evolving. So what does it mean in a way ontological and critical dialogic pedagogy? For me, it means, first of all, ontological, an ontology, it's very confusing philosophical terms and religious even terms. But I use it in a tradition that heavily rooted in the idea that ontology is heavily rooted in the life of people. So from that point of view, for me, there are two points very important. One is coming from Bakhtinian dialogic educator and educationalist Alexander Sidorkin, who arguing the ontology and ontological view on dialogue means that humanity defined by dialogue. So a human being is first of all dialogical being, and that's why it means ontological. The second kind of lack of my approach, ontological approach, is rooted in Bakhtin, who argued that meaning-making process is essentially dialogic, which means that meaning is not rooted in statements as traditional view on meaning-making, but on the meaning is rooted in relationship among people, among and he Bakhtin clarified as the relationship meaning rooted in relationship between question and answer, but not any question and answer, but really serious question when people really want for information. It's not the questions like testing questions like 2 + 2 = that's a schoolish type of question. It's not genuine question because the teacher knows what is the 2 + 2 = 4. Plus, the teacher is not even interested in that particular. The teacher was what teacher interested is whether or not the student knows that. And relationship between that serious question and authentic question with the serious answer, where the person is seriously trying to approach another person, trying to seriously approach to that question. So the meaning is relationship between the question and answer. And of course, the question can be implied question. It's not obvious open question, and not even well-articulated question. And an answer could be also very kind of fuzzy in that sense. But again, the meaning is rooted in that relationship.
So can I stop you for a second? It seems that you're basing your definition of dialogic education, of dialogic pedagogy, on meaning-making. Usually, I think it's usually that people think that education is about getting information, knowing things that you didn't know before, not meaning making, but just kind of like learning about what there is, just information wise. Can you tell the difference between what's the meaning making and what's this more conventional way of knowing?
Yeah, again, coming from my understanding of Bakhtin, the meaning making process is always creative process. It's and it's unfinalized process, which means that there is no end, there is no kind of bottom of this process. It can continue. It's always in a way interrupted rather than finalized. We can continue and continue and continue, and it's always authorial, which means it's we author our meaning. We transcend the existing meaning, and based on that existing meaning, but we transcend that and moving forward. And it could be on the big scale, like we can think about big meaning of the, I don't know, theory of relativity, something that nobody even heard before. Or it could be a very local scale. It can be maybe very new for us, and but not new for some other people. It's also very contextual and unpredictable and situated.
Okay, so this sounds very abstract. Can you give us an example of dialogic pedagogy?
That's good. And what's interesting is, on one hand, it's very easy to give example because outside of school, traditional school, and some even innovative school, we're constantly involved in this dialogue. What Bakhtin was talking about, that, but in school is it's usually neither students nor teachers involved in that type of dialogue. So in a way, any dialogue, even like now, the dialogue that's happened now, that I don't know what kind of questions you're asking me, and hopefully you're asking questions of your interest.
Yeah,
right. Not something that's just
here an example of dialogue.
Yeah, right.
Just so what happens?
Yes. So in a way, our even interview this can be example of this dialogic, even dialogic pedagogy or dialogic education in some ways. But if so, in a way, if you need to look in school in order to capture that, you need to find moments outside of this conventional education. And my personal examples of that, I experienced that both in my classes, also when I work with the children, and my students in after school program. And my kind of, I don't know, but this is probably my favorite example.
It involved
a boy called, I called him, it's not his real name, Zion. It was in Latin American Community Center, has happened when I worked with my students, future teachers, so they had this teaching practicum. And a teaching practicum involved just to engage with the kids on the area of the kids' interests, and to find how you can kind of adjust and tune into the kids' activities, and sometimes bring your own activities, but something that kids will have real interest. And I really discourage my students to work on the homework, to help kids with the homework. And usually will come when the time when the kids already finish their homeworks. And the reason for that, because the kids' homeworks, unfortunately, was not very authentic from dialogic point of view.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes kids if they procrastinate with their homework and keep doing that. So at some point, my students, staff of Latin American Community Center asked them to help a boy, one of the boy who was in fourth grade, his name is Zion, to work on his homework. And my students tried to do that, but he was really very reluctant to do that homework, first of all, and second, to use their help. So my students asked me to help them.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I hated the situations because they're very non-authentic mm-hmm. for me. And kind of kids really want to finish that in many ways very, very stupid and meaningless homework to do to start playing games. So I came with Zion, and what he was doing, I noticed that he was copying words, so-called new words that the textbook considered new for him. And he needed to copy the word three times and that put in a sentence. And what's interesting, I immediately saw that behind, which indicates such a reluctance of his activity, it was that he might copy the word three times, making completely different spelling mistakes, which was pretty obvious because the words was one after another, and he refused to consider that mistakes and fix them, because for him, okay, it's done, three times written, that's done, and the sentence was absolutely meaningless and non-interesting and so on and so forth. So I offered him a game, just playing a game. My goal was kind of get through this, create some kind of a game so can get through this the homework as fast as possible and start doing something else which is more meaningful for the child. But at the same time, he will be not in trouble with his school by not doing his homework. So the game it's kind of what is called Scribble.
Scrabble, something
like that, which is basically find words within a word. For example, there was a word, let's say game, and you can think about GA, which is in the United States, GA is an abbreviation of the state of Georgia, or ME means me, or you can also find AM, This is another word, so at least three words, and kind of become very interesting. So he started looking and noticing, and I was noticing. We were not doing very competitive games. It's more like interesting to find, oh, what's more?
What else?
What else? Mm-hmm. I immediately noticed that the Zion became very, very interested in that game, and his this type of mistakes disappeared because that became useful for him to write this three times. Because by writing, it facilitated him to find new words in that. Even sentences become more interesting because they become part of this thinking about new words. Also, we kind of the game will be spread on the sentences as well because there are some words there and we can play with them as well. And at some point, the word was, I still remember, exit, which is, I'm not sure I understand why textbook considered this word is new for Zion or kids like Zion.
Maybe spelling just, you know.
Maybe spelling, I don't know how they decide that. And so that he put exit and he said X as a word and it. And he actually surprised me because I was surprised that he knows the word X. And I asked him, what does it mean, word X? Mm-hmm. And he was saying, oh, it's like my mom form ex-boyfriend. Mm. And so suddenly the conversation became about this ex-boyfriend, and he asked me like why some people become so bad, and asked him what he meant, and he talked about how his boyfriend was very bad to his mom, they fight all the time, but I asked him how they treat him, and he said actually he treated him very, very, very well, and he missed him.
He liked him
because he read him, and he took him for some sport games, mm-hmm. and they spent time together, and so he kind of was perplexed, how come he can be good mm-hmm. with him and so bad to his mom. And he was very upset how he was with mom. And we start talking about how relationship can be, sometimes good people cannot stand each other. We talked about that. And suddenly Zion started thinking about his relationship with his cousin. Mm. So we talked about, which was very interesting. And at some point, suddenly, as I was yelling, oh, I remember, look at this exit. And suddenly, like, again, he switched attention to the word exit. Mm-hmm. And I said, what do you remember? I know it's called somewhere. And he couldn't figure out what the word is, and I couldn't figure out what he's talking even about. Mm-hmm. And he went to his staff and said, "What? How this word called that consists of two real words?" And the staff member said, compounds. And he said, oh, exit is a compound word. Because there is X and it. Mm-hmm. And next to us was a girl, Maria, who was working on her homework. And mm-hmm. she said, no, it's not. Without even looking at us. I remember she was like sitting next to us. And no, it's not. And we said, like, why not? And she said, no, it's not. And I could see that she couldn't articulate why not. And I tried to help her. And I was thinking, well, is it because you think it's not? Because X and exit, like these two words, do not contribute to the word exit. They don't add meaning. Like what it's it. X is maybe like out, something like that. Mm-hmm. But what it's it, anything to do with the word exit? What's meaning of the word mm-hmm. exit? And she said she was very excited. And mm-hmm. she started talking, oh, that's exactly what I meant by that. Mm-hmm. And so we start talking about that. Incidentally, when I tell that story later to my graduate student, back then graduate student, Kathy von Duke, she was saying, Eugene, you're wrong. And Maria was wrong. Zion was right. It's compound word because it's coming from the Greek word exodus.
Yeah.
And odos means way, out way. Mm-hmm. So, and it is kind of a phonetic part of this odos. So in this case, it's compound word from her point of view. I don't know. I'm still need to know language specialist whether or not it's a compound or not. Mm-hmm. Anyway, then we start looking at the different things that contributes to the meaning of the words, which is I tell kids that it's called morphemes, and we start looking at that. Like for example, they notice what it was written somewhere. It was apples. So S is part of the morpheme because it contributes to the meaning of the word. Mm-hmm. And we start looking at any words around. By the way, the kids, Zion forgot about his idea that he wants to finish as soon as possible and move to something else. For me, this is, back to you ask, what's dialogic pedagogy? For me, this is example of dialogic pedagogy because we were all of us, all four of us, I would say, Zion, Marie, and me were engaged in this meaning-making process where we were taking inquiries, emerging inquiries very seriously about words, about human relations, mm-hmm. about why good people cannot stand each other, mm-hmm. about what's compound words and what's not compound words, about what's its morphemes, and like where they are and what how they change meaning of the words. Mm-hmm. And so for me, that was a dialogic pedagogy in on steroids, I would say.
Very interesting example and very rich example. What I see there in this example is that you didn't plan to do that. You didn't know what he was going to come up with or that you would be teaching him about morphemes or something like that. So I would add to that that one of the big important things about the dialogic pedagogy is this surprise and unpredictability that people expect from each other. You don't expect to talk about things that you already all everybody knows, but to surprise each other with something new. And everybody learns in that situation, mm-hmm. both teachers and students in some way. But there are also other things. Okay, so do you want to continue now for or to stop and then continue next time? Because it's 20 minutes already, hour.
Yeah, podcast. I think that may be a good time to stop and think about where our listeners might have questions and what they might mm-hmm. want to know more about dialogic pedagogy. I know that next topic that we plan is what is dialogue. But let's see, we can put this on our podcast and see maybe, or not podcast, on Facebook, and see maybe our mm-hmm. listeners, mm-hmm. we might want to know some more about what's dialogic pedagogy.
Yeah, I think that we still have to know more about dialogic pedagogy, even using just this example, because I pointed out that there is one difference between dialogic pedagogy and the more convenient pedagogy, and that's this unpredictability of the what will come. But there are many different examples in this example, different aspects that we could describe knowing this example. So I think we could continue. I'm for continuing this next time.
Okay, well, thank you very much, and we'll see what our listeners might say about that. Thank you. Bye.